I am part of the Mandarin Museum and Historical Society. We're here today, both myself and Bob Kurowski, doing some filming of historic places here in Mandarin. It's May 1996. We thought we'd take you on a little tour of some of the historic places and beautiful places in Mandarin before they disappear, and to have a record of them. So why don't we start our tour right here in front of Dr. James' gravesite. These stairs are the only remaining part of the grave of Dr. James Hall that was located up about 20 feet from here. These stairs used to lead up to Dr. Hall's gravestone and historical marker. In 1974, the Duval Medical Society moved the tombstone and marker to their headquarters on Lomax Street in Riverside because of so much vandalism in this area. The Mandarin Museum and Historical Society moved all the historical markers and gravestones back to Mandarin in 1995. Since Dr. Hall was originally from this area, he lived and was buried in this area. The gravestone and plaque and fence are now located directly behind the Walter Jones Post Office and General Store on the corner of Mandarin and Brady Roads. Dr. Hall was born in 1760 in Keene, New Hampshire, and there's little known of his childhood until the age of 17. He enlisted in the 16th Regiment of the Militia in the state of New Hampshire for the Continental Service. At the age of 19, he was a Revolutionary War soldier. Spain had declared war on England and occupied West Florida. At the conclusion of the Revolutionary War, Spain received East Florida by an exchange with the British for the Bahama Islands. There are no records of Dr. Hall from 1781 to 1790. And at this latter date, he received a Spanish land grant in East Florida consisting of 775 acres near Julington Creek. It's suggested because of his real estate holdings and interest in the Spanish land grants that these may have been important factors in his moving to this area. Dr. Hall married Eleanor Pritchard, who was the widow of Jacksonville's first mayor, first settler. Eleanor was the daughter of Daniel and Prudence Plummer from Plummer Cove area. Eleanor's first husband, Robert Pritchard, died in 1804 at the age of 42. Eleanor then, a year later, married Dr. Hall. Eleanor and James Hall had one daughter, whose name was also Eleanor, who later married Oliver Wood, who built Jacksonville's first hotel in 1851 and was one of the first mayors also of Jacksonville. Oliver Wood is buried in the same small cemetery plot with Dr. Hall alongside of him. Dr. Hall died in 1837 at the age of 77. Although other physicians had practiced for short periods of time in Florida, Dr. Hall was the very first known doctor to practice in Duval County after the area had become known as Duval County. He was the first physician to practice in Florida following the annexation of the United States. And as you can see, this area is much overgrown with weeds and native plants. And thus the conclusion of this area. We thought we'd go down to County Dock now and look at the property that the city has just recently built, the Webb Farm. Before we do start our little tour today, I'd like to point out that this is no longer a cemetery. It's on private land. Much like many of the places in Mandarin that have disappeared. We are fortunate to have what we do have, and we will show you from now on some of the historical places that still exist. can see by looking around some of the famous people that were buried here to Mandarin, the Plumbers, the Plummer family being one of the early settlers of Plumbers Cove. We have Flynn's buried here, Bowden's, many families. It has now been brought forth and cleaned up and is at a point of renovation, possibly a fence put around it in the future. The trustees have great ideas of preserving this area, and hopefully it will always be a beautiful area to come to in Mandarin, but one that not many people know about. And we just think it's a pristine area, one that most people in Mandarin have said, a plumber cemetery, we have never seen it. It's been a secret for many years, and now it is part of our history, and we're just so pleased to be here to show it to you. This barn is not visible from any street or anything around here. As you can tell, it's just absolutely quiet, nothing but birds singing. It's surrounded by woods and overgrown for years and years. In fact, the impression is that we're deep in the forest back here with lots of trees around. A study was done on this barn, and there's a question as to actually when it was born. Up there it says on two pieces of wood, 1876. But after research was done, that wood is totally different from the rest of the wood of the barn. So it's questionable whether it was built before then or after then. But somebody very definitely put those two pieces of wood up there. And we are on the way back to the main part of the park, which will be the Webb Jones house. Plans were to grow oranges, but records indicate that he grew Irish potatoes, tomatoes, cucumbers, and strawberries on this property. Since he was in poor health, living in the warm climate could also have been a reason for choosing the Florida area to live in. Mary Graff, in her book, Mandarin on the St. John, says, he purchased a riverfront house site and then built Webb Wharf, which extended 1,000 feet into the St. John's River. There was a railroad track which extended the full length of the wharf. Therefore, the steamers could pick up the crates of fruit and vegetables and ship them to the northern cities. Major Webb was very active in the Mandarin community. Among other things, he prepared the contract for the building of the original Church of Our Savior, the Episcopal Church, in 1883. The Webb house and property were later sold to the Walter Jones family, who in turn sold it to the city of Jacksonville in 1995. Plans for the property include restoration and renovation of the property and house, and turning it into a historical park in the very near future. We're now standing in the front of the Webb house, which is quite obviously in need of a lot of repair, but it holds a great deal of history. The porch, which extends out facing towards the river, extended clear around to the side. Later on, the Jones family added on this room on the right-hand side. They would have big gatherings out here, family gatherings, friends and relatives, and there was a little pool, a little waiting pool over there. They also had a tennis court down towards the river that was shared by everyone in the community. But soon this will be renovated and part of the park and a very important piece of the park. We're thrilled to have it. We're standing on the corner of a County Dock Road and Mandarin Road that has a lot of traffic. We're standing across looking at the property that's called Triangle Farm. Obviously, it's a piece of property that is in a triangle, bound by Mandarin Road, Loretto Road, and down County Dock Road. This was a piece of property that Major William Webb sold to Major L.O. Parker, who was also a retired Army officer. It was 10 acres of orange groves back then, and it was the home of our beloved Mandarin historian, Jean Morrow, when she was a young girl. There was an old house over there and a barn closer to County Dock Road. She loved this beautiful area, as we all do. It has recently been purchased by the Presbyterian Church. It has recently been purchased by the Presbyterian Church and will, very near future, have a church located on it. Looking at now was the original home of J.W. Lockwood, but is known as the Coleman House. Since Dr. Coleman was the only doctor in the Mandarin area, among two or three doctors in the Mandarin area, in the latter half of the 18th century, Dr. Henry A. Coleman came to Mandarin from Palatka, Florida. He came to Florida like so many other people. He hoped the warm climate would improve his family's health. Originally, this property had a small orange grove in the back, like so many other homes. The house was completely renovated several years ago, and the addition was added that is quite new just recently. Jones Post Office and General Store, which stood at the ridge. The original Post Office and General Store stood at the end of Store Lane, which is just west of here, which was the very first post office that was built in 1830. This is the second post office, which was built in 1911. The original Post Office General Store that was on the river was completed in total reverse of this post office. It had the general store located on the left and the post office on the right. And then, as I said, in 1911, this one was built. It was the first spot, the original post office down on Store Lane that was built in 1830, was the very first spot that Harriet Beecher Stowe saw Mandarin. She came with her son Frederick to pick up the mail. Mrs. Stowe had rented a cotton plantation across the river in what is called Laurel Grove, but now is known as Orange Park. Back to this beautiful building, Walter Jones was appointed the 18th postmaster in 1906 at the original old post office. This post office, as I said, was built in 1911. Agnes Jones, or as she is affectionately known as Miss Agnes, Aggie, followed her father and was appointed postmaster in 1928. This post office was closed in 1963. A new post office was built on State Road 13 or San Jose Boulevard. And then another building was constructed on Sunbeam Road, which is now the new post office. The Mandarin Museum and Historical Society have plans to restore and renovate this building. It will have brought back its original condition and most likely be a very good replica of the old building. There's an architect hired and plans have already been completed. Hopefully, we will complete all the renovation within a year. This used to be, to many Mandarin families, a meeting place for people in the summertime or in the winter. They'd come up here and they remember riding their bike up here, getting a Coca-Cola, getting some candy, and just spending the time of day with Miss Aggie talking. She was known as a very generous and kind person who often filled food orders free for people who couldn't afford it. This is a very special store and it will look beautiful once it's renovated. We're standing in front of the Mandarin Community Club on Mandarin Road, facing north. The original building was located approximately 100 feet towards Mandarin Road, and it was constructed in 1869 through the efforts of Harriet Beecher Stowe and the Mandarin community. It served as a branch of the Freedmen's Bureau, and then in 1870 it functioned as a community church and school. Calvin Stowe conducted his non-denominational Bible readings, first in his home and then in this first building. Harriet preferred to do the decorating rather than work at any of the talking at the readings. She many times would cut foliage and arrange it for the altar. Harriet persuaded Calvin to join the Episcopal faith, and with the help of several other prominent families in the area, started the Episcopal Church of Our Savior. She was instrumental in raising funds for the building on a piece of property approximately a quarter mile from here. Back to this building, the Mandarin Community Club that we're standing in front of. In the winter of 1872, the building, the one closer to the road, was burned down, and in the same year, 1872, it was rebuilt. For 50 years, it continued to function as a church and then a school. In 1917, the Liberty League was formed during World War I. Following the war, the members of the Liberty League kept assembling, and the Liberty League kept assembling with more social and civic functions. They decided to stay together and form what is now called the Mandarin Community Club, which was started in 1923. The building also contained a school. Mr. and Mrs. Edward Jones purchased the school and dedicated it to their father, Walter Jones, and Miss Fanny Brown, who were the founders of the community club. Mr. Jones then donated this building in 1938 to the Mandarin Community Club. Since the building was located so close to Mandarin Road, in 1953, it was moved back to this location and a stage was added for the purpose of having performances for the Mandarin Players, who were an amateur group of players. But it might be classified, this Mandarin Community Club, as being the most important historical building in Mandarin. We're standing in front of the community club still, but what we're looking at is the temporary home of our Mandarin Museum and Historical Society. The name has been changed, we dropped community, but it was, before this, the Kate Munson Well Baby Clinic, where people would bring their babies for shots, etc. It has functioned as many different things over the years. It was a library at one point, but it's a perfect home for us, and we are renting it from the community club, and we have renovated this side of the building. The river. The trees behind us, to the left of the house, were on the Stowe property. The biggest tree, actually on the right-hand side, is the tree that was used as a part of the cottage of Harriet Beecher Stowe's cottage. This is the third home that has been here. Harriet Beecher Stowe's home, first of all, then it belonged to the Jack B. Nickel family. That house was dismantled 2 years ago, and this new house is in its place. We're standing at the corner of Store Lane and Mandarin Roads, and we're looking directly at the Brown House, which is located on the northwest corner of Store Lane. It was built approximately in 1880. John C. Brown built this home on the property where his parents and family had their first home. potter, Charlie Brown, who lived here as a juvenile. And the house has been moved back from its original location and is also going through extensive renovations.